Hi, my name is Rachel, and I'm a clinical dietitian in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Today, we're going to be talking about gastric residual volumes in relation to enteral nutrition. So to start, let's review what gastric residuals are. So in the fed state, the stomach produces about 2 to 3 liters of gastric acid per day. In our patients who are in a fasted state, the stomach still produces gastric acid, but only about 500 to 1,000 milliliters a day. Gastric acid combines with digestive enzymes to break down the nutrition that goes into our stomach. To check gastric acid, you can insert a syringe into a feeding tube and draw back or aspirate that gastric acid into the syringe, and that's how we monitor gastric residual volumes. So historically, this has been used in critically ill patients because about 30 to 70% of critical ill patients have gastric dysmotility. And it's been thought that the higher amount of volume of gastric residuals you have, the less likely your patient is tolerating tube feeding because it would be sitting in the stomach. And vice versa, the lesser amount of volume you would have with gastric residual volumes would mean that the formula is going through your patient's stomach and into the digestive tract. So although this is a very easy procedure to do and it's very routine, there are some negative side effects that can happen. Studies have shown that ICU patients only receive about 50% of their prescribed volume in their tube feeding. And this can be due to a variety of reasons. Maybe our tube feeding wasn't started or initiated and advanced appropriately, or maybe it was held for procedures. Another reason can be because it's being held for gastric residual volumes. And this threshold usually varies widely across institutions, anywhere from 100 milliliters up to 500 milliliters. A second reason that monitoring gastric residual volumes isn't the best is because it takes a lot of nursing time. In patients who are receiving continuous feedings, it's usually monitored every 4 to 6 hours or before every intermittent feeding if a patient's on an intermittent schedule. Lastly, monitoring gastric residual volumes can increase the likelihood that the feeding tube will clog. So when the enteral nutrition formula, specifically the protein in it, comes in contact with gastric acid, that protein coagulates. And when that happens in a feeding tube, when you're checking gastric residual volumes, that protein coagulates in the tube and can increase the likelihood of it clogging. So what are the guidelines on checking gastric residual volumes? So the current guidelines come from the ASPEN 2016 critical care guidelines, which state that monitoring gastric residual volumes should not be a part of routine ICU care. If hospitals are hesitant to stop checking gastric residual volumes, tube feeding should not be held unless the gastric residual volume is above 500 milliliters. This 500 milliliter threshold came from 3 randomized controlled trials that demonstrated no difference in the rates of pneumonia, regurgitation, or aspiration when the threshold for monitoring gastric residual volumes was 500 milliliters. The rationale for not checking gastric residuals at all came from 3 randomized controlled trials and 1 prospective study that all showed that there was no difference in pneumonia rates in patients who had their gastric residual volumes monitored and those that did not. 2 studies actually also showed that patients who did not have their gastric residuals monitored had a greater rate of tube feeding infusion, which we know is important because our patients are not receiving the prescribed rate already. One study did show an increased rate of vomiting in patients who weren't having their residuals checked. However, overall, there was no difference in the groups in the rate of GI tolerance. So if we're not checking gastric residual volumes, how can we tell if our patients are tolerating tube feeding? We can do that through a variety of ways. The first being physical examination of our patients. So is their stomach distended? Could it be firm? Or are they complaining of abdominal pain? We can also look at imaging. Maybe they have a KUB or a CT scan done to look at their bowels. We can look and see, are they having regular bowel movements? Can we keep things moving that way? And lastly, the most obvious would be vomiting or constant nausea. To help reduce aspiration risk and improve overall tube feeding tolerance, we can also do a variety of things. First being making sure our patient's head of bed is at least 30 degrees, making sure our nursing is doing great oral care on our patients to reduce that aspiration risk. We can also monitor their blood glucose values. So we want to make sure our patients have adequate glycemic control so they don't develop gastroparesis. We can take a look at their medication list and maybe see if our doctors could decrease the amount of narcotics or sedatives they're on, because that decreases gastric motility. Again, looking at if they are having bowel movements, maybe we need to start a bowel regimen on our patients. Next could be starting prokinetic agents to help move things along. And lastly, placing a post-pyloric tube if they're still not tolerating tube feeding. I hope this information and presentation was helpful to all of you. I would encourage you to look at your hospital or institution's current policy on gastric residual monitoring, or maybe your hospital doesn't have one, and this would be great information to use to create one. If you have any questions or thoughts, please enter them in the comments section below. Thanks so much for watching.